Hey, hey, welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of the Teacher's Lounge. We are in season four, and we are just delighted to be back. Just give a little shout out to Brother Donovan. He's not feeling too well tonight, so he's home nursing his little ailment. Before we go any further, we here at the Teacher's Lounge, we have to give thanks to Minister Malik Shabazz and the Get Up and Stand Up Show for sharing his platform with the Teacher's Lounge Talk Show every Thursday from 8 to 9 p.m. This has been 4 wonderful years, and we're hoping to continue on with the Teacher's Lounge Talk Show and the Get Up, Stand Up Show. We also want to give thanks to Available Geeks and Brother David for sponsoring the Teacher's Lounge Talk Show. You have to understand, this gives teachers, students, educators, a voice that we can control. This is teachers. I'm in the classroom, Brother Will used to be. We're here, we're on the front line. So we can tell you what's going on, okay? And you can hear it from us. I tell you, so wonderful to be here at the Mothership. This is my first time hosting this season, so I'm very excited. Got to give a shout out to Brother Watkins, Mr. RJ Watkins, who is the ruler here of WHPR TV 33 Studios. Thank you so much, sir. How you doing, Brother Will?
Hey, doing great.
I like that sweatshirt. Oh, yeah. Sporting the Teacher's Lounge logo, yes. By the way, the Teacher's Lounge, we have a wonderful new website. I believe it is the Detroit Teacher's Lounge. Visit us on the website at presently if you want to sponsor. If you want to advertise with us, go straight to our website. There'll be wonderful opportunities for you to partner with us as we carry on the voices of teachers, parents, and students. Speaking of students, we have a very special guest. Let me tell you about this young lady. She is a Cass Tech junior.
Senior.
Don't say yeah. Any short, huh?
Right? Time flies. This young lady has beautiful, outstanding goals that she is going to share with you. And what you probably will never know by looking at this young lady is she had a cancer diagnosis. This young lady is 17 years old. And when she was 15, I believe, 15?
16.
She was diagnosed with the big dreaded C. I had to ask this young lady, this strong woman, to come on to share her journey with us. Before we get to Brianna, we want to encourage you all to give us a call and get involved in this conversation. Here at the Teacher's Lounge, give us a call at 313-868-0342 or 313-868-0351 or 313-868-4336. Our lines are open. Give us a call here at the Teacher's Lounge. Again, we have Brianna Smith. Brianna Smith is a Cass Tech student. You want to say hello to our listening audience?
Hi.
We also have her wonderful sister.
Hello.
Her wonderful sister. Speak right in that mic, sis.
Hello.
And her name is Cindy, and I remember that because I have a sister named Cindy, who is my favorite sister of them all. So you always have a hot place in my heart. Well, Cindy's always do.
Why, thank you.
Yes. So, you know, Brianna, I want to talk with you. You know, being 16 and being told that you have cancer, I have to ask you, what went through your mind when the doctor said to you at 16 years old, young lady, you have cancer? Right in that mind.
Well, first stage is always denial. So
amen. Amen.
I was denying it up until the last test results came back where it verified that I had cancer. Okay. And really and truly, when I first found out, I couldn't fathom it. I couldn't wrap my head around it. It was like I was still in a dream.
Yeah.
And it just didn't seem real. And so, like, my brain couldn't really make the connection as early on as that. But I was just thinking that this is one other thing that I'm going to have to get through.
I like what you said about denial. Because, you know, we come from a people that's very spiritual. Mm-hmm. And we know about naming it and claiming it. And just because you said it doesn't mean I have it. And your reality is not mine.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think it was very wise of you to just kind of click that off and say, wait a minute now. Because that's your spirit coming up and saying, wait a minute. They're trying to put something on you that you can fight. Mm-hmm. You know? And I love that. So I have to ask you. Before you received this diagnosis, what symptoms did you have, or if any?
Yeah, so I didn't have the normal symptoms that came with my cancer.
Okay.
It was very sudden, if any. So usually, someone with Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is the type of cancer that I have, and in such a progressive stage, I was in stage 4, the most advanced stage. I was supposed to be tired, like if I walked upstairs, I was supposed to feel out of breath. I was supposed to be very sleepy. I was supposed to not really be able to breathe very well when I lie down and go to bed because I had a tumor. Like one of the largest tumors I had was around my trachea. Mm-hmm. So when I would lay down, it was supposed to constrict my airway. But I didn't feel any of that. And the one thing that presented itself was my lymph node in my collarbone. It was swollen, but it was like unusually large. Mm-hmm. Because you know sometimes your lymph nodes would swell up if you were to get sick, because it's fighting off the infection. But the doctor that I went to said that it was concerning because it was so large. And so she said it could be cancerous, and then that's when everything started snowballing.
Were you physically active, or you were like an athlete?
I was a student.
yeah, student athlete, I guess.
Yeah, you know, I was running around all day long. Mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm, I had everything on my plate at all times. So yeah, I did. I also dance at church.
Praise him. Yeah. That's I just couldn't fathom being 16 and receiving that. And sister Cindy, I have to ask you, how when you heard it, did you call down the spirits and did you tell the devil he's a liar? And did you
lay hands on him? He is a liar.
Yes, he is.
He is a liar because my baby is right here.
Praise him.
And she is good.
Yes, ma'am.
He is a liar, but it was devastating.
Yes, ma'am.
I was on my way to work. My mom called me, and I just could not move. I was crying and crying and praying.
Yeah.
Crying and praying at the same time. And that's all I could do was cry and pray.
Yeah.
And cry and pray. But I was like her. Yeah. I was in denial for a long time, like, until you tell me, yes, I don't want to know, it may be, I don't want to hear that.
Yeah.
Because no.
My.
But she's a strong girl.
Well, I'll tell you.
She's strong. Everyone,
I had the
young
blessing.
Young lady, I mean. I'm sorry.
Young woman? Yes. See, I had the pleasure of teaching this young lady when she was in the 8th grade. It was my first year at Flix. And my cute little Brianna story. And I tell this story often. My first week. And, you know, I'm teaching and stuff, doing my thing and everything. And it was Brianna. And remember, I don't really know no names and everything. It was Brianna who came up to me and said, you know, I really hope you had a great first week. Wow. And it just, to the point, I remember it to this day. And I share that memory fondly because she didn't have to say anything. You know, she could have just said, bye, have a good weekend. But to take into her heart that I was new, it was my first week in the new school, and just to come up to me and say, I hope you had a good first week, really touched my heart. And I just want to thank you for that.
What grade was this?
Eighth grade.
Because if an eighth grader came up to me and said, I hope you had a first good week because it's getting ready to get real after this. So, you know, I would have been a little worried. I said, uh-oh.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, and mind you, I really didn't know her because she was first week of school, you know. And just to know that she stepped out, you know, and just presented herself in such a warm, friendly, beautiful way, just always stuck out to me, you know. And you, to this day, you stand out to me. And last year when we were talking, because, you know, Brianna came to visit me, CAS Tech students, Renaissance students, Flick students coming back home. And she came to visit me, and I noticed she didn't have any hair. And I didn't notice it right away. We were just talking.
You're the only one.
I saw the face. I just like, yeah, blah, 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 blah. And I was just like, something's different about you. I just can't put my finger. What is it? And she was like, my hair. And I was like, oh, you cut your hair. And then she let me know, yeah, well, it's the, you know, and then she told me about the big C. And I'm like, oh, you know, and it really humbled me. And I can honestly say, where did you get your strength from? Because when she was talking about it, it was like the event happened 10 years ago. It was in the past, you know. She was talking about an event that was long ago. And I'm like, where did you get that from? Where did you get that strength from?
I don't know.
Please know. It's in you.
Yeah.
It's just naturally in you.
It is.
It must.
It is.
Because, listen, I remember having menstrual cramps when I was your age, and I thought I was going to die. I can't go to school, and give me the pills, and oh, mommy, I can't. And my mom said, okay, you lay down, and you know, you rest up, because you bleeding, you know? But, I mean, so, and you wouldn't let cancer stop you from going to school. Speaking of, how did this diagnosis affect your relationship with school?
So, for anyone who knows me, they know that I am a great student. Okay, mm-hmm. I love school.
She does.
Love it.
Okay, I love school and all of my teachers. And even when I was going to the doctor that night, I was doing an essay for my AP English class, and they were like, "Oh, you might have to stay overnight." I'm like, "No, I don't. Wow. I have to turn this in this essay tomorrow."
Amazing.
I can't stay. I'm sorry.
Amazing.
Yeah, and so when I found out that I wasn't going to be able to go back to school, it was very stressful because I knew that my classes were very rigorous, mm-hmm. and we would do things in class every day. We would have a new assignment every day. And so I just was thinking about how behind I was going to be, and especially since I didn't know how long I was going to be out. Even though they say, like, they gave me an estimate of 5 to 6 months, I was like, wow, that's the whole school year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so I really struggled with letting go of that anxiety that I had to do work, mm-hmm. because I'd always, you know, stuck myself to, like, these deadlines. I'm like, I have a homework to do here. I have this to study. And not having that really to worry about, it was a whole new thing.
Because
all I know was my schoolwork.
Wow. So maybe that was the Lord's way of trying to free you up a little bit.
It was.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, to be so young, to be so focused on deadlines, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's different. Mm-hmm. I wasn't focused on deadlines when I was here. You know, I was focused on other things, you know what I mean? Definitely not school. And just listening to you say that, you know, you were upset because you were going to miss school. I would think most students would say, oh, I can't go to school because. Right. Listen, you heard me. I wanted to stay out because of my monthly, right. You know, and I did several times, you know. And I just, this passion for school, where do you get that?
It's always been in me.
I love
like
that.
Ever since I was like in kindergarten, my mom told me that. You used to come home straight after school, run to the study room, and you would do your homework. That was the first thing you do.
Wow.
And you would barely even say hi to anybody. You would do your homework first, and then everything else.
Yeah.
And I found a passion for learning. I love to learn.
Yeah.
And all my teachers, fortunately, have been very great teachers.
Yeah, man.
In every subject. And so I just think that I can attribute my passion for learning to them.
Amen.
There are certain things And it's hard to explain, you know, you can get metaphysical about it or whatever, but there are certain things, certain people are born with certain things.
Yes.
And I just met her, but she has a certain air about her. Yeah. She's like she an does. Old soul, mm-hmm. so to speak.
Yeah.
And, you know, without going into that too much, because, you know, without the risk of, well, it's not a risk. I just happen to believe in, you know, reincarnation, yeah, things like that. And I think, you know, there's something, you have an aura about you. So where when you say you don't know where it came from somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this was your time to have whatever that is.
Yeah.
And to have such an attitude the way you seem to have it, yeah. it's not a mistake. You know, I'm not going to go into a lot of details about how I think things like that come about, but people are born with certain things, and mm-hmm. not just for you, but for you to be telling your story, and I'm sure you've talked to other students, and I'm sure adults and students alike have learned a lot from you, and as young as you are, I think you still have a lot to, you have a lot more to offer.
Yes.
I think this story is going to be one where, you know, we might end up buying your book in a few years.
Amen.
You know, but DPS, it's what's refreshing about Brianna. Our students are so stereotyped.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, if we don't get these stories told, which is why we like a lot of young people to come on our show, mm-hmm. that if we don't let people know the gems that we have, that we truly have, mm-hmm. you know, we'll keep watching television or we'll listen to the news because stupid makes the news, not mm-hmm. people like this.
Yes.
You know, you'll get the wrong impression. So, you know, without stretching that out too much, there's something very special about you. I just met you, but yeah. I can.
Thank you.
I can feel it.
Yes. And I know you mentioned how you appreciate your teachers. Did they provide accommodations for you?
Yeah. So
what were they?
When I told them, they basically told me to not worry about deadlines, which was like, wow, easier said than done.
That's right.
For me. But they did give me a lot of room to, you know, go through what I had to do and then also try to do work if I could.
Mm-hmm.
But they were basically telling me for homework to come as a second thought and my health as the primary thought.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that helped a lot, you know, because even though I was the one that was putting on all that stress, you know, they were like, it's okay.
Yeah.
You don't have to, you know, do this if you aren't up to it. Do this only if you're up to it.
Yeah. So I appreciate that. That's a DPSCD teacher. Okay. We support our children. Okay. We love our children. And I tell you, Brianna, I just think that, you know, the teachers that have looked out for you thus far, and they're still looking out for you?
Yes.
Okay. Sure. I'm just curious. I kind of know the answer to it, but did you ever consider, well, you know, I do have this diagnosis. Maybe I'm just going to fall back and not turn this assignment in just yet because Empire's on tonight. You know, did you ever, you know what I mean? Have you ever thought about, you know, just falling back a little bit? You can tell the truth. You can tell the truth. Go ahead, Alger. Tell the truth, Shane.
I doubt it.
You know, honestly, I'm going to say no.
Amen.
It wasn't a thought of, let me not do this assignment. It was always I would try to do an assignment, but literally my mind could not focus on the task at hand, and I would have to force myself to stop.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, when you say your mind couldn't focus, is that a symptom of the disease?
Yeah, so I just recently found this out because I thought it was just the stress that I was dealing with, but one of my friends who is also a cancer survivor, she told me that when you go through chemotherapy, you know, you can, your brain, you know, your memory could get bad and it might be hard to focus.
Oh.
And that was what's happening to me. I couldn't remember what I did the day before a lot of times. I couldn't stick to one task at a time. I love reading. I couldn't read because my mind would like drift off unintentionally. And so many times that I just was like, you know what, I'm going to have to come back to this.
Yeah.
And it kept happening. But fortunately now, you know, it's getting better.
Because you're in remission right now.
Yes.
Yes. Remission. Okay, how do you feel about that?
Feel great about that.
Yes, obviously. Now, yeah, what about your life plan? Now, when I met you, this young lady, business card. She had a business card. Business card, right? With her goal, what she wanted to be, a neurosurgeon, wasn't it?
It was.
Neurosurgeon on the card. I'm like, listen, you got my vote when you run for president.
Right.
You got my vote. So do you still want to, you know, do that? You still want to pursue medicine?
No.
No.
I want to pursue a career in computer science now.
Really? Now, what changed that?
Yeah, so I started applying for college in about July. Mm-hmm. And I'm a part of this scholarship program called Wolverine Pathways. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they're trying to get us into the University of Michigan. And so we were doing those applications. And when we got to the essay and it was asking about, you know, our future aspirations, I had to sit back and reevaluate what my goals were. And it was because I understood how my lifestyle would be if I was to be a physician. But at the time, it seemed worth it because I was already putting everyone else before myself. Mm-hmm. And so it was like, well, it's only right that I become a doctor because that's how I've been catering to people in my life in general. But I realized that I can help people in other ways. I don't have to sacrifice my personal health time and time again to help someone. You know, I can help myself and help people at the same time. And so I was thinking about what I really love doing. And I realized that science, you know, sometimes it becomes a chore to me, mm-hmm. but math never becomes a chore.
Wow.
It's always fun.
I know Mr. Walker is, yes, he's going, yes, girl. That's her math teacher, former math teacher at Flix. Yes.
Yeah, so I started looking into that. And then, you know, computer science, it intrigued me.
Now, I understand, maybe I'm wrong, Cass Tech, don't you choose a major in the ninth grade and you stick with that major?
Yes.
So were you able to switch your major?
No, I didn't have to. Oh. So for my curriculum, chemical, biological, usually most of the people who want to become doctors take that curriculum, but it's a lot of math and science. And so this year, it worked out perfectly because a lot of my science classes, I have microbiology and organic chemistry. I love both chemistry, math. So, math class is really like my main focus because it's the hardest math class at CAS, AP Calculus BC.
Wow.
And so it kind of all worked itself out.
Amen. Wow. Amen. You know, you're saying subjects that I said last week, I never took calculus. It wasn't required,
right?
So I never took it in college. Microbiology, okay, all right. I took biology, okay, and I struggled with that. I got a B in it, you know. And you're microbiology and calculus, and I'm just astounded when I see young people and they have it going on. Mm-hmm. I'm so proud, and I get a little giddy. You know, and so now that you decided you want to be a computer scientist, what do you want to do with that? What would you like to do with that?
So I'm thinking about a field in cybersecurity. And it's, yeah, I joined the robotics club in my school and the cybersecurity club in my school just because I've done robotics before. And so I really liked the whole, first of all, teamwork of it. And, you know, you have to program a robot in order for it to work. Mm-hmm. I like programming. And so that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to challenge myself with that. And then the cybersecurity field intrigued me because it dealt with a lot of finding a problem and figuring out what's wrong with it and then fixing it. And I don't know. I just like the idea of, you know, having a problem, presenting itself to me and figuring it out because that's what I always do.
Yeah. I love that. We have Brianna Smith here with us. You know, listen, I kind of want to change the conversation a little bit. We'll come back to your recovery and all of that. And I just want to chat with you, you know, because so much is going on today. And normally we would have had calls by now, but I understand. You got Brett Kavanaugh going on. I get it, okay? How do you feel about that? This whole Brett Kavanaugh, you know, and she's got to tell those men about the rape, okay? I mean, how do you feel about what you saw? I know we were talking, and we were going to call it the green in the lobby, and you educated me on some things that I didn't know about. So just curious, how do you feel? What's your opinion about Brett Kavanaugh? We're doing current events now.
Well.
Get a young person's take on it. I know. I'm getting a young person's take.
I think that a lot of the times when you have someone who's very high up in government, there's a lot of things that they try to let slide and to make it seem like it's not a big deal. And I understand that a lot of people want the facts, but a lot of times their facts are biased, and they don't look into it enough. Because when, you know, a lot of people have been coming forward with, you know, rape accusations, and people are like, well, they're probably lying, you know, why are they coming out now? But if you listen to her story, she has been talking about her experiences years before she was even thought of in the news.
See, I didn't know that. And you educated me on that. I tell you, that's why I love young people. I tell you, never shun away from young people. They will always put you on the right path if you let them. Yeah. You got to let them. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you think there's some credibility to her story?
I do.
Yeah, I know we were talking out there, and everybody was agreeing. I guess they say, hey, look at this guy here. He's saying something to make sense.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
For women, you know, a lot of things happen to women, and they say, why didn't you report it at the time? It could be cultural things. It could be family things. Yeah. And while a man, even if it might not be embarrassing, somebody, you know, talk to women who wanted to say something, but they didn't know how they would be projected. And a male-dominated world, what did you do to make this happen?
Right.
You know.
Very callous. And tell us about this rape. Yeah,
and when
okay.
you can sit back and say, as a man, I had a youthful indiscretion, that is something that a woman carries around with her. Forever. I was almost hoping that the lady would say that, you know, I've been carrying this around for so long, and now you're getting ready to get this position. This is my best way to get revenge. I wanted her to be, I didn't really watch it that much because I'm just not a fan of politics. I thought this whole thing was just, I didn't think anybody was sincere. I didn't think the people who were trying to get the facts from her were sincere. I didn't think the people who were defending Kavanaugh were sincere. It just seems like everybody had an agenda with this whole thing. You know, actually, this should have been something, well, I can't say it shouldn't have been public, but I can understand why women would keep that to themselves. Sure. And just, it just showed you how insensitive these men were. And then going to Donald Trump and asking him about, you know, physical and sexual abuse, it's like, I mean, you know, that's like going to an arsonist and ask them about fire prevention. It just didn't make any sense to me, you know. So that's an interesting take that you have on it. It's a mature take that you have on. But I just thought the whole thing was a farce. I didn't respect the whole process at all. The only thing that I'm glad about is that she got her story out. I mean, you're a doctor. You're going to be faced with all of these questions. There must have been something she really felt, that I'm going to risk all of this, because you know they're going to make a circus. Even the well-intentioned people, they're going to make a circus out of it. So I don't see this woman trying to gain anything, you know, monetarily or materially. So I just, when I first heard about it, I just kind of believed it. I just, they'll tell you here, I'm not a fan of politicians and politics.
He's not.
So in the first place.
He's in the people. So, yeah. He loves children. like children. You know. What about you? What about you, Cindy? How did you feel about the Brett Kavanaugh? Do you have an opinion about it?
Well, I really didn't watch any, but I watched like 5 minutes.
Uh-huh.
And he sounded like Trump, basically. He didn't answer any questions out of the questions I heard, and he went all around them.
Yeah.
So it actually sounded like Trump was right there. So.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Junior, are we going to take a break? Okay. We got to pay some bills, everybody. Thank We're going to take a break. We'll be back very shortly. We have Brianna Smith, Cass Tech student, cancer survivor. We're going to talk some current events with Brianna. Don't go away. Be back.
You're watching WHPS, Highland Park, Detroit. The views and opinions expressed on the following show are not necessarily the views and opinions of WHPS, its affiliates, management, or sponsors.
There's only one thing kids take seriously, being a kid. They don't worry about getting sick or hurt. They're just here for a good time. But we take kids very seriously. At Children's Hospital of Michigan, we only have one focus and one purpose, the health of your child. Because there's a big difference in a hospital that also cares for kids and a hospital that only cares for kids. That's why we've devoted our lives to caring for your child, just like you. The new Children's Hospital of Michigan.
I was terrified of photos.
This was the only pair of pants I had.
I needed help. Life was sad.
Didn't have a great quality of life.
Everything was centered around food.
But enough was enough. I chose weight loss surgery with Your New Self, DMC's Weight Loss Solutions Program.
Attend a free weight loss seminar in person or online to learn more about surgical and non-surgical weight loss.
172 pounds lighter, I feel great.
I made the change. They made it possible.
With 20 top surgeons performing over a dozen of the latest knee, hip, and joint procedures at the hospitals you know and trust, we only have one question. Where does it hurt? Orthopedics and sports medicine at the DMC. Register for a free seminar and discover your options. Orthopedics and sports medicine at the DMC. The official doctors of our Detroit Tigers and Red Wings. With offices throughout Southeast Michigan and more than 30 rehabilitation locations. Trust the experts the pros trust. Register for a free seminar today.
One of the problems is they forget who elected them. They forget who supported them, who encouraged people to vote for them. So we got to hold people accountable. They become these people, judges, elected officials become part of the status quo, thereby becoming part of the problem.
Stand up. Don't give up the fight.
We need to build our own system. We need to build a system based on righteousness, a system based on some divine principles, a system based on equality and justice. They call it the justice system, but it's just us. We need justice, fairness, everybody.
If you call yourself a trigger, you will act like a trigger.
Criminals are organized. We are getting organized. So we thank God for the Detroit 300. Let's give God a hand clap.
Well, you know, it's been a long grind, and the city's had a lot of things go wrong, but I feel like things are going the right direction right now, and we're happy to be a part of it.
All right, any other words you want to say?
Well, glad you've been on our side.
Detroit, for Detroiters first. Self-determination can't just be a slogan. This got to be a way of life.
All right.
Hey, Somebody
made it back to the nick of time. We won't say who.
I tell you, you know, when we have these breaks, people run off and run around. And it's funny watching them scamper back.
It wasn't
Cindy
me.
Cindy just made it.
It wasn't me.
And all you heard was this. All you heard. So it was funny. It was funny. So welcome back to the Teacher's Lounge. I am Mrs. Piper, your host. Again, I want to say hi to Facebook. Facebook, I mean no disrespect. I'm sorry, I am just now greeting you. Hello, Facebook, hello. We have a wonderful guest audience, Facebook. We have a wonderful young guest, Miss Brianna Smith, young 17-year-old student in her senior year at Cass Tech High School. And she is talking about a severe diagnosis that she received, which she has survived. That is in remission. And I'm just curious, I mentioned the senior year. What are your plans this year? Are you excited about the prom and the big football game and all that stuff? Talk to me about that.
You know, I sort of have a different perspective on all of it, not coming back. Okay. Because like I said, I was diagnosed in January. And so from January to June, you know, I was out of school. And during that time, I basically lost like 99% of my friends because they weren't such a great support system. Mm-hmm. A lot of kids, I guess, don't know what to say in situations like that. And a lot of them, you know, made promises to me that they would, you know, support me and come see me and all this. And they just didn't.
Yeah.
And I realized, you know, that I needed more out of my friendships and of a more valuable, you know, support system. So when I got back to school, pretty much on my own.
Wow.
I do still have school spirit, so like I'll still be going to games and stuff, but it's not how it, you know, used to be.
Yeah, were you disappointed? You say you were disappointed.
I really was, especially at first. I was very disappointed and hurt because, you know, these are people that I thought I could count on. That's why I told them in the first place, because I wanted them to be there for me.
Now, when you first told them, you know, initially, were they like, what? You joking? Or did they break down and cry? Or?
Yeah, so their initial response was, are you going to die?
Wow, that's straight to the point.
That's cute.
Yeah, you know, they just got scared.
Yeah,
because when a lot of times when young people, even older people, when they hear the word cancer, they think that it means
it's a death sentence. Yeah,
and it's not. And I told them that no, my cancer is a very curable cancer. I will be cured.
Amen. You are cured.
Yes. I am.
Yes.
So, what do you attribute? Do you think just when you think about all of that with the a kid you went to school with, do you think it was fear or, you know, how did you process all of that? And then if you could, what about, it sounds like it was only a few. Would you like to talk about anybody that stuck with you through and through that was, you know, a friend that you were glad that was around?
Yeah. So,
say their name. Maybe
I think that for me, when I was trying to understand why no one was trying to figure out, you know, or trying to keep up with me, I thought, well, maybe, you know, they're busy with their lives and all that, you know, maybe they just got too busy. But when it, you know, constantly kept happening, you know, and they would say, no, I'm gonna come see you this day, and then didn't say, oh, I forgot, and then kept doing it. I think that some young people didn't learn proper like coping skills, and so when something bad happens to them, and even to someone that they know, they don't know what to say or how to support them. And so instead of like stumbling over words and having awkward silences, they'd rather not say anything at all.
Just get ghost. Yeah.
Yeah. And
do you understand that though? I mean, you sound like you have made peace with that. Have you forgiven them, I guess, is my question? That's abandonment. That's what that is. You were abandoned. Sorry.
She was never abandoned.
Oh, God bless you, Cindy. Not by her family.
Never.
But by the so-called friends.
Yeah. Everybody is not your friend.
Amen. Yes. That's our next question. What did you learn? Yeah.
I did make peace with it. It took me a while because, you know, I told them in January when it happened, and by March, I was like realizing that they weren't gonna show up, and then I started going to therapy, and I was telling them, I was like, I don't understand why no one feels the need to, you know, contact me. And a lot of people say that, oh, I talked to your mom about you. Mm. I said, but you have my number. Why haven't you? So that's how I made peace with it. I talked to my therapist, and she said, well, sometimes they just don't know what to say. Mm-hmm. Because at first I was just angry.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I would have known what to do in that situation. But I understand that I have an emotional maturity, too. Mm-hmm. And so I handle things.
Hold on, caller.
I handle things very differently, I guess, than most people my age would. So I understood that. And then I did call, you know, the most important ones that hurt me the most. And I asked them why. Because I don't like to just get my side of the story.
Sure.
I like to understand it from all points of view. And since I couldn't understand it for myself, I was like, okay, I'm going to ask them. I'm going to tell them how I feel. And then give them a chance to explain themselves. And none of them had an answer. They said, I don't really know why I didn't. And, you know, some of them tried to say that they were too busy. But the one that said they were too busy lived 10 minutes away from me.
Yeah.
And I said, you live 10 minutes away. You couldn't have spared 15, 20 minutes to stop by. Because you said you would.
Yeah.
So I just said to them that, you know, I made it this far. It was May by this time. Yeah. So I made it 4 months without you. I don't need you in my life anymore. And it wasn't like a hostile type of thing. It was more of, we fulfilled our purposes in each other's lives.
Mm-hmm.
And I am moving on now. And so I don't want to take that with me.
That's so mature.
Yes.
We encourage you to be a part of this conversation. Here at the Teacher's Lounge, give us a call, 313-868-0342 or 313-868-0351. Our final call-in number is 313-868-4336. We're going to go to our lines. Caller, welcome to the Teacher's Lounge. What's on your mind this evening? You're talking to Brianna Smith.
Hello. I'm very proud to be talking to you. I'm a cancer survivor myself.
Praise God.
Amen. But question I have is, I was the president of the Detroit Public School Board, and I was wondering, when I got cancer, it was my reaction to myself, first of all, because like you said, when you hear the word, it scared you, and then my reaction to my family's reaction to me, and I wonder how your family reacted. Because I know my children is always, even today, I've had it 3 times, is always scared that I'm going to stress, a lot of stress on myself, and stress and cancer does not match. Even when I got into with the school board, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah,
please.
I got into a problem with the school board as a president, one thing my children was upset because I had cancer that time for the second time was they don't think I should go through a trial. Daddy, you got to figure this out because that's too much stress. Cancer and stress don't mix. So I wonder, how is your family, how they react to you since once you had cancer? Because I know how mine is scared of every little thing I do now.
Yeah.
The stress with cancer. And I had it for 2016 was my third bout with cancer.
Wow.
And I'm blessed. I'm highly blessed.
Praise him, brother.
Yeah, first time I had it, I thought it was over with. No one could tell me any different. It's the end. It's over. They couldn't tell me any different. And when people come to visit you for that short time, like you said, I was thinking, oh, that's why they're coming to visit me. They're not telling me. It's over. And then I live.
Yeah.
and then going and catching it two times. So I just wonder, how is your family reacting to you now? Are they treating you with kid gloves or what?
That's an excellent question. Thank you so much, Carl.
Great question. Thank you.
Throughout this whole thing, my mom and my dad have been at the hospital with me. So when I got the news, they were there. When I got my CAT scan and my PET scan back, they saw the results. They were there for my chemo and radiation treatments. They were there. And so they had to watch me themselves. And, you know, my parents are older. You know, they're in their 60s. And so
I resemble that right now.
Sorry.
That's okay. No, I'm not. I'm glad to be here.
That's right.
But, you don't even look it, baby. You don't even look it.
To my surprise, and I think to everyone's surprise, the most emotional out of the three of us, my mom, my dad, and me, it was my dad.
Yeah.
Every time the group of doctors would come in and tell me something new that was happening, he would be the one to break down. And I've gotten this from them and all my family and all my friends who stayed. They said that the way that you handle things, you're so calm and collected, and that helps me to get through it. Amen. And when I was talking to my sister, she was saying, "You're so calm. Why are you so calm?"
Too calm.
And I was like, I don't know. It's just how I deal with it. I take it. And I find a way to make peace with it, but, you know, internally. And I also knew that it probably would have given them a heart attack if I would have been breaking down every second of the day.
Yeah.
And so I really...
Still being strong for everyone.
Yeah.
Still being strong. Unbelievable.
Yeah, but
it's a little delicate, but you seem more like a spiritual person than a religious person. And I try and be very careful when I make that statement. But there are some people who are religious to me, and it kind of scares me.
Yeah.
Because I don't even think they believe it. But they're. And comment on that. How did you. What is your take on things spiritually or, you know, religiously? You just seem like more of a spiritual person. I'm kind of got myself a little tongue-tied here because I'm always trying to be careful with that subject because it's very sensitive. But you just have this spiritual air about you that seems non-denominational to me. But so would you talk about that a little?
Can you explain?
Well, I think spiritual people, they have an air like you. You know, you say you were just calm. You know, there's just this air, like you already know something that the rest of us doesn't. Yeah. And that's not something that you can get from just going to church or reading a book or whatever that you believe in. There's just, it's kind of hard to say, but for the lack of a better word, you just seem like more of a spiritual person than somebody that's just, it's hard for me to say.
Yeah, I understand.
I think, you know.
Well, you are different. You are unique.
Thank you.
You are very unique. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting. Maybe the Lord chose you for your little battle because he's raising you to do something very, very, very unique. I mean, it has to be. It has to be.
Yeah, I actually want to comment like on that.
Mm-hmm. Please. Hold on. Oh my goodness. Look at this. Mm-hmm. We're lining up. Caller, welcome to the Teacher's Lounge. We have 5 minutes. Yes, caller.
Yes, hello?
Yes, sir.
My name is Richard Tucker. I'm Rihanna's brother. And I just wanted to call in and thank you guys. This is my first time watching y'all's show. I really enjoy y'all's show. Like the platform that you guys have and allowing young people to come on and show their experience. And I just wanted to say that Brianna is definitely one of a kind, and she's the strongest person I know. Yes. She has brought my whole family together, more closer than ever.
Well, Well, amen.
Well, there Thanks. You go.
Thank you so much. That's beautiful.
Before
That's beautiful.
You take that next call, yes. could you let her? I want to hear that thought that you had
I
about
want
that.
To.
Yeah, I did have a sort of war with myself through like religion mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. spirituality throughout all this. And it's because, you know, I was brought up in the church.
Sure,
and
sure.
so my mom took comfort in ministers coming in and giving mm-hmm. prayer.
Amen.
And, you know, I appreciated it. I did. But that wasn't what I needed.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And sure. it wasn't like I knew off bat like what I needed, mm-hmm. but I do know that I took some comfort in religion. I did. Like the third day I was in the hospital, all new, I had to get a biopsy done of the lymph node in my neck and my bone marrow. And it was the first time I had any type of surgery, broke any type of bones. Mm. And so I was scared. And my cousin, who's a doctor, Crystal, she told me that you are on a path to do so many great things, and the devil doesn't know what to do to stop you. So yeah. he's going to try the most ridiculous things yeah. to get you off your path.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And she was also the one who told me that it's okay to not be okay.
Yes.
And up until that time, I wasn't thinking of it like that. She was like, it's okay to say it's not fair, because it's not. Right. Because you're great, and you're mm-hmm. supposed to, you know, do big things, and you had all these plans set up, and now you just can't do that right now, and it's not fair.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when, like, that was the first time I realized that, yeah, that it's not.
Right.
But I did make peace with that as well.
Amen.
But I do consider myself more of a spiritual person than a religious
Amen.
Person.
Yes. I'm gonna take this call. Caller, welcome to the Teacher's Lounge. You're talking with Brianna Smith, Cast Tech student and cancer survivor. Yes, sir. How are
okay.
you?
Quickly, I just want to say, from what I heard, that she has already, the divine spirit and God is already in her. You are the goddess that will heal and be a testimony to others, because
yes.
you are already doing it. It has nothing to do with what they taught you in church. It's nothing to do with religion.
Yes.
It's got all to do with the divine power mm-hmm. of the goddess that's already in you.
Amen.
Thank you for taking my call.
God bless you. That's beautiful.
Oh, thank Amen. You. Thank
you. Beautiful. Yeah. How about that?
Yes.
Now, you know, we have about maybe 2 minutes left. I just want to ask you quickly, Brianna, you did mention therapy.
Yes.
You went to therapy.
I did.
And can you talk about how that has healed you? Because, you know, many of us, you know, we thumbs down on therapy. And every now and then I know I can use some, you know. So
we all can.
Yeah, we all can. We all can. And you being young and already have experienced, you know, interaction with a therapist, can you talk quickly about how maybe what the therapist has done for you?
Yeah. So I will say that therapy isn't something to be looked down upon.
Right.
I don't know why that mm-hmm. is, that we feel like something has to be very wrong with us to have to seek out therapy. Therapist is someone who will support you when someone else maybe can't in your life.
Right.
And I was lucky enough to have a therapist who could relate directly to me, because she's a breast cancer survivor.
Okay.
And so we have a lot of conversations that have brought me peace, because a lot of times I didn't want to talk to other people because I knew they just couldn't understand,
mm-hmm.
because they weren't going through what I was going through.
Mm-hmm.
It was a fact.
Yeah.
And so I knew that they couldn't tell me anything that I didn't already know.
Okay, we got this. Producer gave us this. That means we got to wrap up really quick. Can you just tell, looking at camera, any young person that is going through a trial, going through a triumph, can you give them words of encouragement not to give up, please?
Yeah. I will say that remember that you are important. You are the most important person in your life, no matter what.
Amen.
And even if it may be a terminal illness, do not stop spreading peace
yes.
and love and joy in you and everyone else.
Amen. Amen.
And that's basically it.
You know, I think if you haven't considered, you should consider chronicling all of this. And
mm-hmm. Write a book, girl.
Just...
Yes. You know, write a book, girl.
Yeah. Seriously.
Right. We got to wrap it up.
Okay.
Thank you so much. We will be back here next Thursday at 8 o'clock to watch Fear at the Teacher's Lounge. Brianna, thank you so much. Thank you, Cynthia.
You're welcome.
And listen, we'll see you here next week, Thursday, 8 o'clock, Teacher's Lounge. Thank you so much. Later, Facebook. Thank you.
They forget who supported them, who encouraged people to vote for them. So we got to hold people accountable. They become these people, judges, elected officials become part of the status quo, thereby becoming part of the problem.
Stand up. Don't give up the fight.
You're watching WHPS, Highland Park, Detroit.
We are a part of a public-private partnership to place more than 40 kiosks throughout Wayne County to allow you to pay your essential bills and delinquent taxes in one safe, convenient location.
DT Energy introduced this kiosk program to allow Metro Detroiters greater freedom to pay your energy and other bills when and how you desire, by cash, personal check, or credit card.
At the Detroit Water Department, we are pleased to join our friends so you can now pay your water bill on the DivDat kiosk network.
The kiosks are located in our respective downtown offices, as well as Rite Aid stores and community centers across the county.
As the president of the DivDat Kiosk Network, our mission is to stamp out convenience fees and help you.
Make sure to take advantage of the no-fee kiosks to stay current on your tax, energy, and water bills. Stop by today to learn more about how to enter into a payment plan in the newly extended interest rate reduction program.
Please visit us at DTE Energy,
the Wayne County Treasurer's Office,
or DWSD. We're here to help.